Kubo-san Doesn't Let It Be is the first manga I have ever covered for Red Hot Go. So how much do I read to get an accurate impression? With anime, I watch the first three episodes, but what should the standard be for manga? Here's what I've figured out. The average volume of manga has about 10 to 12 chapters. Since I would expect a manga to be good by the end of the first volume, I will base my first impressions on the first 15 chapters. I'd like to thank my patrons, Jaman5 and Pixcalibur, as well as Fisheyes, Rhymation, and Sage Panic for recommending Kubo-san Doesn't Leave It Be for Red Hot Go. If you would like me to cover any other manga, TV shows, or video games, please let me know in the comments. After reading the first 15 chapters of Kubo-san, I've come to realize that it's not the type of manga you pick up for an engaging story or enthralling characters. Instead, this story is more concerned with being wholesome, very much in the same vein as Takagi-san, albeit with less originality. The plot revolves around Shirashi, a student so plain-looking and without character that most people don't notice his presence, and his desk neighbor, Kubo, the only person who can reliably find him, and who I believe may very well be his first real friend. Of course, beneath the friendship, these two share a desire for something more, that I first thought both characters were aware of, but now I'm not so sure. Kubo can be a bit of a bully and a bit of a brat. In the first 15 chapters, she blackmails Shirashi, purposefully makes him uncomfortable, and just generally uses her more bold personality to dominate him. However, as the story goes on, you realize that he just lets it roll off him like water off a duck's back. He might get flustered at that moment, but like Takagi-san, the interactions that leave him flustered are single instances that contribute little to the broader narrative. I do like the dynamic between the two. Being someone whose classmates never notice him, Shirashi is a bit of a loner. He's quiet, passive, and typically keeps to himself. He doesn't dislike spending time with Kubo. He never laments being in her company, but he seemingly lacks the drive to make friends. Kubo, on the other hand, is a social butterfly. She has other friends and exudes this confidence that Shirashi just doesn't. She isn't unflappable the way Takagi is. She regularly becomes flustered. However, I was disappointed by the 15th chapter, when we find out that she doesn't realize her feelings for Shirashi yet. I'm sorry, what? With how direct she can be and how eager she is to become closer to him, I cannot believe that she is clueless about her own feelings. It seems like something the author has done because that's how you write romance. No, it isn't. Takagi, for instance, understands her feelings for Nishikata, and the groundwork she lays for their inevitable relationship is what makes that story so engaging. Shirogane and Shinomiya understand how they feel about one another, but their character arcs revolve around the insecurities and pride that get in the way. Ayumu understands how he feels about Urushi, and it drives his entire character motivation. The only thing this reveal accomplishes is making the reader realize that the characters are starting at the very beginning. Out of all the things I was interested to see from a character like Kubo, realize you like the guy you obviously like wasn't one of them. I do like the idea that Shirashi goes completely unnoticed by those around him. Sometimes this idea can get a little absurd, like some days he's so plain-looking that infrared light can pass straight through him. Still, it's a decent representation of what some people his age might feel. Someone so unextraordinary that the rest of the world forgets them. No one is really that invisible, but I'm sure some feel as though they are. And I can see how this manga might act as wish fulfillment for that type of person. That even the quiet kid who no one notices can get to be friends and possibly more with a cute girl who puts in all the legwork. But the most critical question for a manga trying to be heartwarmingly wholesome is, does it accomplish its goal of being heartwarmingly wholesome? Some parts certainly are. There are conversations and situations between these two that do get those warm and fuzzy feels flowing. But other times it can delve into generic tropes that have zero value, like when Kubo is insecure about the size of her bust. And other times the narrative can get downright infuriating, like when Shirashi wonders who left him the Valentine's Day chocolate. Yeah, gee, I wonder who it could possibly be. It's not like you only have one friend who's acting awfully suspicious about that chocolate, you absolute doofus. So far, the manga has been content to set up the status quo, making it clear that the two live close together, introducing us to siblings and side characters, and exploring the mechanics of Shirashi's lack of being noticed. While I'm sure it's wrapping up on introducing new elements, it's probably not going to delve into any substantial arcs. This seems like a stick to the status quo till the end kind of story. I don't mind that formula on paper, as long as the narrative makes up for the lack of story or character progression with something else. So while this manga is plagued with generic elements, annoying moments, and a central duo who are characterless and antagonistic respectively, the narrative provides an interesting main gimmick and some good wholesome feels. From ice cold to red hot, I give Kubo-san Doesn't Let It Be a rating of lukewarm. I'll certainly keep reading and see where the story goes. And that is it for this episode of Red Hot Go. I'd like to thank my patrons, Orion Tran, Lars Espen, Data52, Jaman5, Shark, Pixcalibur, Alberto Cruz, Tyler Bennett, Tenka, Jeremy Pashik, Fireclaw, and Soren. If you would like to support the channel further, consider becoming a patron yourself. Thank you all very much for watching, and I will see you next time.